Tonight, as promised, the last programme in the present series comes from New York, which, as usual, seems to be pretty well awash with movie makers. So in the next 40 minutes, we'll be talking to Robin Williams, Francis Coppola and Kevin Kline. We'll be looking at the hype surrounding the opening of what is certainly intended to be the summer's biggest blockbuster, Warren Beatty's screen version of Dick Tracy. And in addition to all that, I'll be previewing some of the films that'll be coming your way over the next few weeks. Now, I don't know, nobody knows whether Dick Tracy will turn out to be a box office blockbuster. What I do know is that Back to the Future 3 already is one. It took $50 million in its first 2 weeks and it's still going strong. In it, the familiar repertory company, Michael J. Fox as Marty McFly, Christopher Lloyd as Doc Brown, Thomas F. Wilson as an early and particularly nasty ancestor of bullying Biff Tannen, are to be found in the Wild West of 1885. By this time it's Doc who's in trouble. Well, he's about to be shot, actually, and I think you could call that trouble. And it's Marty who has to nip back in the time-travelling DeLorean to rescue him. A simple task, you might think, given a car that appears to operate far better in time and space than it ever did on the road. But, of course, nothing simple for this pair. For a start, Doc falls in love with the town's new schoolmarm, Mary Steenburgen, and shows far more interest in pursuing her than in saving his own, and come to that, Marty's hide. You will, I think, enjoy it, because where Back to the Future 2 was harsh, confusing and too densely plotted, Future 3, directed as usual by Robert Zemeckis, is much closer in mood and charm and the interplay of characters to the original. A very pleasant way, in fact, to round off the series, and apparently Future 3 will round off the series, because at 29, Michael J. Fox doesn't want to play 17 anymore, and who could blame him? Anyway, it opens in London on July the 13th. Perhaps the most controversial film now being shot in New York is the screened version of Tom Wolfe's Manhattan satire, Bonfire of the Vanities. In this, Tom Hanks plays a Wall Street yuppie who one night inadvertently drives into the South Bronx, knocks down and kills a young black, and promptly ruins his own life. Thereafter, much of the action revolves around Hanks's trial here at the South Bronx courthouse. When director Brian De Palma and crew turned up to shoot exterior scenes at the courthouse, it was, like today, one of the sunniest days of the year. But naturally, the script demanded heavy rain. Well, that's the way it goes when you're making movies. And so a balmy summer's day was turned into wet and windy midwinter with the aid of Hollywood know-how, and in particular, giant sprinklers and a couple of 100-foot cranes. The controversy over Bonfire the movie emerged early on with some distinctly unexpected, not to say odd, casting. Tom Hanks, for instance, is a somewhat bizarre choice for Sherman McCoy, the yuppie master of the universe. But stranger still is the selection of the normally macho Bruce Willis to play Peter Fallow, the sleazy, inebriated, and in the novel, definitely British tabloid journalist. Willis apparently took English lessons to prepare for the part, but the vowel sounds didn't seem to rub off, because he was reportedly still sounding about as English as Sylvester Stallone. The loudest outcry over Bonfire, however, occurred in the Bronx, where it was thought the film might convey a negative image of a borough which is already about as negative as a borough can be. In places, the burned-out South Bronx, which stretches for several miles, looks like a war zone, and in a sense it is. I mean, there were 483 murders, 594 rapes, and 16,142 robberies there last year alone. So it's a bit hard to see how a film could make it look much worse, whatever it did. Nevertheless, local politicians declared that Bonfire went out of its way to denigrate the Bronx in some particularly offensive ways.
The Bronx doesn't only have pimps and prostitutes and muggers and thieves and murderers. In fact, we do have good people who are trying hard to build and rebuild the Bronx.
Because of the protests, Warner Brothers have agreed to put a disclaimer at the end of the movie, saying the events portrayed are fictitious. But Bonfire's problems spread way beyond the Bronx. When the unit moved to Manhattan, the Metropolitan Museum of Art wouldn't let them film inside the building for fear of negative publicity. The repeated refusal to allow the Bonfire filmmakers access to buildings and locations in New York is seen by many as a worrying new trend.
The currency of the 90s, I think, and anything having to do with the media, is access. Bonfire of the Vanities is a book about New York. Someone decides to make a movie about that book, about New York, and have a bad view of the city. And people say, no, I don't want you to do that. Well, that shouldn't matter whether they want it to happen or not. It's someone's vision of the truth, and we're free to disagree or agree with that. But no, people hold access to public buildings. So you suddenly, no, you can't use my courthouse because you might say something bad about this area and I hold access, so I'll prevent you from doing that. it's a limitation on the free exchange of opinions and ideas. And I find that offensive. I find that very, very troubling for America and also for the arts.
The thing to bear in mind is that the kind of fuss now surrounding Bonfire of the Vanities crops up regularly every time a movie is shot in the Bronx. The politicians screamed and hollered just as loudly a few years ago during the filming of Fort Apache, the Bronx. Well, I suppose that's what they're paid to do, but sadly for them, they can't seem to arouse quite the same degree of indignation among their own constituents. Indeed, residents of the Bronx actually seem to welcome Bonfire of the Vanities being shot in the neighborhood, regarding it as a rare opportunity to watch movie making at first hand.
This is my first time. I love it. It's exciting.
Big thrill. You see, it's a big thrill. And don't tell my boss about this. It's supposed to be working.
This is our break, and we ran down to see if we could catch a peek. And every time we stand somewhere, they say, get away from me.
Rather more seriously, though, Bonfire of the Vanities is a striking example of how life imitates art in New York. The media circus outside a Brooklyn courthouse during the recent trial of two white youths involved in the killing of a black teenager last year bore an uncanny resemblance to the kind of media circus depicted by Tom Wolfe in his novel. Indeed, New York has experienced some extremely ugly racial incidents in the past year, and there's genuine disquiet about the way filmmakers are depicting the complicated, emotionally charged racial tensions in the city. Last year, Spike Lee's film Do the Right Thing whipped up a nationwide controversy with its explicit portrayal of how racial hostility in one New York neighborhood escalates into violence and sudden death on a hot summer's day. And more recently, the New York-based director, Sidney Lumet, touched a particularly sensitive nerve with his latest picture, Q&A, which features a New York police department riddled with corrupt and racially bigoted cops. These films are, of course, works of fiction, but they touch on elements of the truth. Some depict reality more closely than others. The main charge against the Bonfire screenplay, however, is that its views of New York run to particularly simplistic extremes.
The real problem I have with Bonfire of the Vanities and its view of New York is not unlike a Woody Allen movie. It's written by someone who lives a good life and has this real high-end, low-end view of the city. There's a lot of middle in this town. There's a tremendous amount of middle in New York that gets ignored. You're either real rich or you're real poor, real good, real bad, real greedy, real okay. That's a problem not with the view of New York. It's more a problem, I think, with the narrative.
Read you your Miranda rights and it'll tear your clothes off.
He's interested in producing something of mine.
Your first child.
Oh, Woody Allen's latest picture, Crimes and Misdemeanors, which is last year's movie as far as America is concerned, opens in London on July the 27th and shouldn't be missed whether you prefer the angst-ridden Woody Allen of the memorable one-liners and films like Annie Hall, or that other Woody Allen who thinks he's really Ingmar Bergman and makes pictures like Interiors. Because here he combines both kinds of story, the comic and the melodramatic, in one film. The melodrama deals with the plight of a well-to-do eye specialist, Martin Landau, who has his troublesome mistress, Angelica Houston, bumped off by a hitman and has to live with the resulting guilt. The comedy is provided by Allen himself as an unhappily married and struggling movie director who falls in love with Mia Farrow while he's making a documentary about his wife's brother, Alan Alda, a highly successful TV producer.
The last thing in the world you need is for me to be your biographer. You know, I make these little films on you know, toxic waste and starving children.
Look, I'll be frank with you. You're not my first choice. I'm doing it strictly as a favor to women. Because you haven't worked in a long time. She's embarrassed.
I've worked, it's just that nobody's paying me. I'm, you know, for this film.
Look, I know you don't respect what I do. I understand that. But, you know, I got a closet full of Emmys. You realize that. No, all right, okay, you think that's bullshit. Fine, okay, fine. I understand.
I don't know. Maybe I could use the money to finish my movie, you know? I do have some debts and things.
Idea for farce. A poor loser agrees to do the story of a great man's life, and in the process comes to learn deep values.
Well, the two tales are most tenuously linked, but the threads of both are woven seamlessly together, the deadly seriousness of Landau's story being relieved at just the right intervals by the delightful humour of Alan's predicament, as everybody from his wife, Joanna Gleason, to Mia Farrow and Alan Alda, beautifully cast as a pompous, self-glorifying twit, takes it in turn to dump on him. What the two stories have most in common is that they both look, though from sharply different angles, at the way people behave or should behave in this rather amoral age. Crimes and Misdemeanors is told with a beautiful clarity which disguises the fact that it's actually a very ambitious work, and I doubt if anyone other than Woody Allen could have pulled it off so successfully. Woody Allen, of course, is the archetypal New York filmmaker. Indeed, he's the archetypal New Yorker, inclined to suffer from agoraphobia if he even sets foot outside the city limits. But he's not by any means the only. New York filmmaker. 110 movies were shot here last year, and another 60 have been completed already in 1990. So Tom Brooke has been having a look at some of the pictures currently on location in and around Manhattan.
We'll take Manhattan, the Bronx and Staten Island too. It's lovely going through.
New York is a movie maker's paradise. The impressive skyline, the landmark buildings, the open spaces have long made it a popular location for filmmakers.
Riding along in my automobile, my baby beside me at the wheel.
Matt Dillon has been among the Hollywood stars in New York this summer, cruising along the Henry Hudson Parkway shooting a thriller with co-star Sean Young. Not far away, in more peaceful surroundings, Peter Weir has been working in Central Park, directing Andy McDowell and Gerard Depardieu in a romantic comedy called Green Card. And on the Upper East Side, a red knight has been charging down Fifth Avenue on horseback, pursued by Robin Williams and Jeff Bridges, who are starring in a Terry Gilliam film called The Fisher King. Robin Williams says shooting on location in New York often ends up as a highly charged experience.
You shoot in New York, you immediately, you don't have to decompress, you're in it. You got guys walking up going, how you doing? I like your movie. Or you have guys walking up going, you suck, get away from me. That gives you a reality base. Plus, the people, the actors you get in New York, I mean, even the people playing the smallest part are great. They're really, you know, they live it, they know how to do it.
New York, a hell of a town. The Bronx is up, but the battery's down.
The old ethnic neighborhoods of New York are a major attraction to filmmakers. More than 150 languages are spoken by people in these distinctly different parts of the city, all within a few miles of one another. Chinatown has long been a favorite with Hollywood directors, as has Little Italy.
At one point, virtually everyone who lived here in Little Italy was either Italian-born or of Italian parentage. But nowadays, the neighborhood isn't quite as Italian as it used to be. However, it's still ethnic enough to have served as a major location for one of the summer's most talked-about movies.
Action! Background and procession!
Francis Ford Coppola has been in the neighborhood directing the final sections of his eagerly awaited sequel, The Godfather, The Continuing Story. The movie has been shrouded in secrecy. Getting Coppola to comment has been extremely difficult. The picture is several million pounds over budget and behind schedule.
Cut, good, mark it. Let's do it again, even more people. Let's make it more crowded, that was good.
In this scene, Coppola was getting actor Joe Mantegna to stroll through a street fair in Little Italy.
This is a scene that takes place around the middle of the film, and some of the antagonistic forces of the story are all converging on this kind of feast day, typical feast day.
And is it easy to work on the streets of New York shooting this film?
As you can see, it takes some patience, but it's possible. Bye.
Coppola spent much of his time on location in his aluminium motorhome, his version of Mission Control. It reportedly contains elaborate video editing equipment, a miniature gourmet kitchen, an espresso machine, and a jacuzzi. Others on location, like actor Andy Garcia, had more mundane accommodation. The presence of so many well-known Hollywood actors working on the streets of New York creates a lot of excitement. These young girls in the Fifth Avenue apartment building were elated to find Jeff Bridges and Robin Williams working on the street below. New Yorkers don't seem to mind all the inconvenience movie making often entails.
It's very exciting if you see it and you see the stars, you see Robin Williams and you see, you know, these great people.
And I think for New Yorkers it's unbelievable, you know, to look at your neighborhood and see it transformed. It sort of makes you look at it with a new sense of excitement.
What also makes New York attractive to filmmakers are elements of the city infrastructure. The subway system has been used extensively as a backdrop in countless films, as have distinctive bridges and highways. The physical look of New York played a part in bringing British filmmaker James Dearden to the city to shoot the exterior scenes for his picture, A Kiss Before Dying. He was also pleased to find that New Yorkers generally had a good attitude towards movie making.
Movies is part of the culture here. It's not like in England where they're all very uptight about letting you film anywhere and you don't get all that much cooperation. Here you get the cops, you know, providing police cars to escort you everywhere. You get outriders. On the other hand, it's also a strangely bureaucratic place here. To get permits, it takes sometimes days and they have to go to each different department. But once you get the permission, you get total cooperation. That's what's different.
Mayor's Film Office.
A special city agency operates to help filmmakers in New York. Given that the film industry brings almost £2 billion each year to the local economy, it isn't surprising to find the city eager to do everything it can to please filmmakers.
We'll start from day one. If you're researching a script, we'll help you research the script. We'll help you find your locations, the look you'd want. And then down into when you're shooting, well, we issue your permits, we make sure that you can work on the streets, that a police unit is there to help control traffic and help with the public safety. So we're there every step along the way. We'll cut every bit of red tape and make sure that your work in New York is the best possible.
Rolling! Quiet, please!
But working on location in New York isn't as easy as it sounds. New Yorkers are human. They get short-tempered, and they don't always appreciate cameras on the street. Action. Working after dark can be quite trying, as Sean Young and Matt Dillon found in their long nighttime shoots for A Kiss Before Dying.
When it gets going too long, like you're working and you're trying to fight the conditions, I mean, we're going to have to go back to Times Square a third night, and I'm like, because that place is really scary.
When you're shooting at Times Square, I mean, you know, you had guys that were just coming in the middle of the shot. You know, they come in, jump in the scene, you know. And, you know, it can be difficult, but it also can be really exciting, giving a nice energy, electrifying.
The frenetic pace, the energy of New York is perhaps one of the most compelling factors bringing filmmakers to the city. The relentless activity, which continues at all hours of the day and night, can grate on your nerves. It can also be thrilling.
New York is like, it's like wearing fiberglass underwear. It's kind of like, oh, it looks nice, but ow! It's rough sometimes. And other times, New York in the spring and the fall, there's nothing better. But in the winter and the summer, there can be nothing worse. I mean, you've been in New York in the summer, and when we shot it, it gets to be 110. The air is basically so thick that you see squirrels on respirators. And it's rough. But there's something about it that has this bottom line. It's beyond this, you know, people doing like, how you doing? You know, it's got this level. It's got that whole thing, and it's also got, you know, neighborhoods, welcome, come over here, and got all, now many Vietnamese people come, I take you uptown, excuse me, can you take me to the village? What village? No, the village in New York. Now, what village? No, village in New York. And you get all that stuff, and it just gives you, it's always going, and it's the energy. It's like grabbing a live electrical cable. You know, doof, whoa, you wake up, and you're immediately outside. As soon as you walk out the door, it's, hey, yo, it's New York, hey, get an attitude, come on, wise up, and that's it.
Now, what we've just been talking about are mainstream commercial movies, which, after all, are the ones that make the big bucks. But in New York, there's still plenty of room, not to say a fair amount of loot, for the little guys, the distributors of low-budget, independent films, the kind the big companies reject scornfully as art house pictures, on the grounds that they're unlikely to take $100 million on their first 2 weeks of release. And probably the most successful of these self-styled little guys is Miramax, a company founded by Harvey Weinstein and his brother Bob, are named rather sweetly after their parents, Miriam and Max. And they tend to specialize in distributing films from the other side of the Atlantic, films like My Left Foot, Scandal, and The Craze.
What is the trick then in selling the small independent, I suppose what would be called art house movies? Is it the marketing? Is that the most important thing?
There's two things. With My Left Foot, it was interesting. We saw the movie in Dublin, and the audience was laughing. We brought the film to America, and this is where the producers and directors hate me in England. So hi to all my producer-director friends. I took the movie, and we screened it for a New York audience. While they loved the film on the first screening, the Irish expressions really threw them off. And, you know, there was no laughter in the cinema. So I talked to Jim Sheridan, the director of the film, and I said, Jim, we've got to do something about this. Why are they laughing in Ireland? And the idea was that the expressions, a jar, for example, in America, you say a jar, you think of a vase, you mean, for flowers. You say a jar in a pub in Ireland, they know what you mean. You mean, but in America, completely over, you know, American audiences have, and a million other things like that, including, I'll say all the words you like, bollocks. We still don't even know what that means. So what we did was we went back with Daniel Day-Lewis and Jim Sheridan, and they were wonderful about the whole thing. They said, Harvey, get lost. We're not doing this. And then finally, you know, at gunpoint, you know, with their families held hostage at my home, you know, they agreed to redo the lines of the film. And we worked on it. And as you can see, it hurt the film because it won Best Film at the New York Critics Award, 2 Academy Awards, and, you know, went on to incredible success. And it was ununderstandable to an American audience and played in theaters all over America.
Glass. No point in drinking out of the bottle, huh?
And now with the big man, with those accents, we had a test of the film in America, and it was in Cincinnati, where My Left Foot had played 16 weeks. And up until Miramax, these movies had never gotten mass distribution. So now, you know, you can bring a film over, you know, like a big man, and, you know that you've got to do a little redubbing just to make it understandable for American audience. So that's part of the marketing. And the other part of the marketing is unbelievable tenacity, aggressive marketing campaigns, and saying that a film like The Big Man or My Left Foot is quality, and quality shouldn't be sold like an art house movie, like, oh, let's have a small little ad and play this at an art house ghetto. The hell with that. Let's, you know, take The Big Man and My Left Foot and, you know, run great ad campaigns, fantastic publicity, you know, and let's sell this the way you would sell, you know, Eddie Murphy movie.
All right, we have two big, healthy men here, ready for a square go. Prepare! Time!
We use North America as a linchpin. If it works in North America, generally it'll work in France, Australia. There's something about, you know, our country, you know, and that translates everywhere else. So why not get it right, you know, and then you'll have a success everywhere. And that's only going to make a stronger British film industry, as opposed to the parochialism I used to deal with when I first came to England. Oh, I'm sorry, this is the way to do it. You mean, it was almost like a class thing, you know what I mean? I should have, like, driven those directors. I think they wanted me to chauffeur them, you mean, and garden, you mean, at their weekend homes.
They're very fussy who they work with, these guys.
Yeah, as opposed to, I think they were waiting to be knighted, some of them.
The bottom line, as they say, is making money. What kind of profit do you make in the course of a year?
We did very well last year, you know, and I think we'll do twice very well this year. And we, I mean, the first 6 months have been, you know, profitable to start. And that's not only good for Miramax, it's good for, you know, the British film industry, it's good for the Italian film industry, which has had a renaissance with Cinema Paradiso. You know, Cinema Paradiso bombed in Italy. We won the Oscar for it here. The movie won the Oscar, but we marketed it to get the Oscar. And then it did better in Italy when they brought the Oscar back. So, yes, it's good to be profitable, but it says to every other filmmaker around the world, don't stop your own personal vision. You know, just get a better marketing and distribution company to handle it.
This last weekend threw New York into a positive fever of excitement, because not only did Dick Tracy open then, and yes, we will get to Dick Tracy eventually, but so did Gremlins 2. Herein, Zach Galligan and Phoebe Cates, the young lovers from the first picture, are trying none too successfully to make their fortunes in the Big Apple, specifically, and this is something of an in-joke for New Yorkers, they're both working in an ultra-modern building, not at all unlike Trump Tower, the erection thrown up by the now maritally and financially beleaguered Donald Trump on Fifth Avenue. In the film, the building is called Clamp Center and is owned by one Daniel Clamp, an asinine tycoon played by John Glover. Nothing works properly in this building, and everything works even less well when Gizmo, you remember Gizmo, the Mogwai, the lovable gremlin, turns up, gets wet, and begins to reproduce himself. The result, of course, is a veritable horde of truly evil gremlins who, having eaten after midnight, which, as you will recall, turns them into total monsters, proceed to tear the place apart.
I think the main question that people have is, creature, what is it that you want? Brad, what we want is, I think, what everyone wants, and what you and your viewers have. Civilization. Diplomacy, compassion, standards, manners, tradition. That's what we're reaching towards. The Geneva Convention, chamber music, Susan Sontag. That's what we aspire to. We want to be civilized. I mean, you take a look at this sale here. Now, was that civilized? No, clearly not. Fun, but in no sense civilized.
Well, it's violent and amusing. The special effects are extremely well done. And like Back to the Future 3, it's a considerable cut above most sequels. The director was Joe Dante, and the producer was Steven Spielberg, who was also the producer of Back to the Future 3. So one way or another, and no matter what else happens this summer, I reckon it's a pretty fair bet that Mr. Spielberg's bank balance is going to put on another hefty bit of weight. One of the factors that helped make New York America's second city for filmmakers is that the theatre still thrives here, though admittedly off-Broadway rather than on. Consequently, the more serious performers tend to gravitate towards the East Coast so they can alternate screenplays with live plays. A case in point is Kevin Klein, who lives in Manhattan and recently opened on stage in Hamlet on the same night as his latest film, I Love You to Death, opened in the cinemas. The film is based on the true story of an Italian-American philanderer whose wife, played by Tracy Ullman, made repeated and hilarious attempts to kill him because of his infidelity, but who, though bullet-ridden and poisoned, survived to forgive her and repent of his wandering ways.
I cheated on my wife.
You committed adultery?
Yes.
How many times?
Five times the last 2 weeks. Wait. No. That's wrong. It was four times this week with three women, and three times last week with two other women. Wow.
I thought it was a riveting story. More so that, I mean, on the title page said this is a true story. I was reading it. It's like reading some tabloid thing, except it was also brilliantly written screenplay, I thought, the structure and the comedy.
There was offbeat casting all the way through that film, wasn't there? I mean, Tracy Ullman playing an American, Joan Plowright playing a Yugoslav mother, Bill Hurt as a biker drug addict.
Yeah. There's Tracy playing the suburban American housewife and virtually the straight man, in a way. She's not, I mean, and she's famous for her outrageous characterizations, and here she had to. There's no wigs, there's no frills, there's no fancy makeup. It's sort of a stripped-down, pure acting part for her. And Joan Plowright's doing this Yugoslavian, bizarre character.
I want Rosalie to stay home and help me with the house cleaning.
House cleaning? I got work to do.
Oh, no!
What's the matter with you two?
Why didn't you tell me you were going to blow up the car?
Well, I thought it would be a nice surprise for you.
What about the film reviews? Did you look at the reviews of I Love You to Death at all?
No, it opened the same day as Hamlet began its first previews, so I didn't want any bad news of any kind. I find I'm hypersensitive to criticism. I want to see froth around the critic's mouth, you know, before I'm convinced that he really loved it. I want unconditional love.
This, of course, is the very heart of American capitalism, and the essence of American capitalism, in the cinema as elsewhere, is consumer choice. So any night and every night, literally dozens of different films are shown in New York. But how do you find out, in a hurry, what's on where? No problem, as they say hereabouts. You simply pick up a phone, put in a quarter, and dial 777-FILM.
And then...
this happens.
If you know the name of the movie you'd like to see, press 1. Using your touch-tone keypad, please enter the first 3 letters of the movie title now.
C-A-T.
Your selection, Cadillac Man, is playing at Lowe's Paramount, 2 Gulf and Western Plaza. Today's remaining show times are 2 o'clock, 4 o'clock, 6 o'clock, 8 o'clock.
And at this stage, I think there's rather more information here than I need. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to the Rose Paramount at 6 o'clock. Thank you very much indeed. Goodbye.
Moviegoing then flourishes in New York as the sheer number of cinemas testifies. But just lately, the customers have been complaining. Curiously enough, considering that Manhattan is home to Madison Avenue, the mecca of the button-down minds and the advertising industry, advertising in American cinemas is a relatively new phenomenon, and it's one that the punters don't like.
I don't want it in my movie, you know, something you pay for. It's okay on TV.
So now, two of the biggest studios, Disney and Warner Brothers, have banned commercials from cinemas when their movies are showing.
People don't want to see commercials in movie theaters. They've been booing. It's been going on now for months and months and months.
This seemingly altruistic move to ban adverts is regarded by some as pure hypocrisy, since many films often appear to be little more than full-length advertisements for millions of dollars worth of associated merchandise. For instance, Disney spent £19 million to make Dick Tracy, and another $19 million to promote it and all the manufactured goods that go with it, in the hope that Tracy will become an even greater licensing hero than Batman was. In the stores, there are Dick Tracy dolls, napkins, keyrings, placemats, posters, backpacks, face masks, handkerchiefs, clothing, and even bedding. The intention is to brainwash the public into buying this stuff. And the more churlishly slow the public is to respond, and it is being slow, the more feverishly Disney hurls its money around to create a more receptive mood.
Dick Tracy, coming next summer to a theater near you.
I'm on my way.
So you can see from all that how deeply Disney and Warner Brothers are opposed to advertising. And yet somehow, all these people seem to know that Dick Tracy is opening this evening. Must be some kind of osmosis.
I've heard so much about it, and it doesn't matter whether I like it or not. I just want to see it. It's kind of like Batman. After I saw it, I really didn't like it, but I just wanted to see it.
It's the hype, the hype. It's the greatest thing yet, you know, since the last thing, since we're Batman. It's the greatest thing since Batman.
How do you know that? You haven't seen it yet.
Well, we've been hearing so much, and McDonald's is doing such an advertisement. It got to be great, you know?
Y'all paying him, right?
What about the cast? Do they appeal to you at
all? Yeah, the cast. There's so many different people in here, so many different stars. We love Madonna, you know, Al Pacino, Dustin Hoffman, even my man Mandy Patinkin's in this movie. He's great. I love him. You know?
There's a rumor Warren Beatty's in it, too.
I heard him. I heard of him before. I love his sister, you know?
Warren Beatty. I hope it'll be exciting. I'm looking forward to seeing Madonna. I hear she's really good in this movie.
And you, it's just Warren Beatty, isn't it?
It's Warren Beatty.
You mind if I call you Dick?
I was beginning to wonder what a girl had to do to get arrested.
Wearing that dress is a step in the right direction.
So what did that first night audience get for its money? Well, for a start, it didn't get a sequel, which makes a nice change these days. What it got instead was quite the best of the 3 potential money spinners of the summer, a movie that simply sets the standard for any future film based on a comic book character. It's inventive, imaginative, and visually it's an absolute knockout. Everything is in the authentically vivid primary colours of a comic strip. Bright greens, reds, blues, yellows, and astonishing makeup turns the villains against whom Tracy, the all-American cop, wages his one-man war into a marvellous army of grotesques. Among those villains, sometimes so heavily disguised as to be practically unrecognisable, are the likes of Dustin Hoffman, James Caan, and Dick Van Dyke. By contrast, Warren Beatty, in pale trench coat and matching fedora, is properly square-jawed and clean-cut, though, as his co-star Madonna remarks, showing a little mileage nowadays. Beatty the director turns Beatty the actor into an unselfish straight man off whom the others bounce most of the humour. Tracy truly comes to life only when he's taking on the heavies, facing the vampish advances of gangster's mole Madonna, or trying to declare his love for his girlfriend, Glenn Headley. He's out of his depth. Crime, he understands, women are a closed book. And when you remember this is Warren Beatty we're talking about, that's quite a joke in itself.
Hello?
You're breaking and entering, you know.
Sorry.
Sit down. Are you gonna arrest me?
were going to arrest you, I'd have done it by now.
And what are you up to, honey?
I think Lips Manless is dead. And I want you to tell me who killed him. Or maybe you weren't on his side. Whose side are you on?
Side I'm always on. Mine.
No grief for Lips?
I'm wearing black underwear.
You know, it's legal for me to take you down to the station and sweat it out of you under the lights.
I sweat a lot better in the dark. I know how you feel. You don't know if you want to hit me or kiss me. I get a lot of that.
Look, you're safe. Big boy's in jail. You're the one that can keep him there. Give me a call.
Well, as you can probably see from that, Beatty's is an unusually subtle performance for this kind of film, but it serves to emphasise how good the rest of the cast is. Madonna, for instance, is back to the form she showed in Desperately Seeking Susan, but the real standout, as eye-catching as, though commendably less flamboyant than, Jack Nicholson in last year's Batman, is Al Pacino as the shambling, hunchbacked chief villain, a sort of Richard III of the mean streets. So will Dick Tracy earn the kind of mega-money that Batman took last year? If there's any justice, yes. Because apart from anything else, it's a much better and more enjoyable picture. Well, judge for yourselves when it opens on July the 6th in London and July the 20th nationwide. And that, alas, is all we have time for now. Film 90 will be back in September, but before then, in a special programme on July the 19th, I'll be talking to Warren Beatty about all manner of things, including, of course, Dick Tracy. You won't want to miss that, so make a note. 10 o'clock, Thursday, July the 19th. And while you're writing that down, here's a scene from David Lynch's Wild at Heart, this year's big prize winner at Cannes, which opens at the end of August. For now, though, from me in New York, goodbye.
Y'all know this one? To read.